Comfort Children's Audio presents Seekers, Book 4, The Last Wilderness, by Erin Hunter. Performed by Julia Fletcher. Copyright 2010 by Working Partners Limited. Production copyright 2010 by HarperCollins Publishers. Chapter 1. Ujurak. Wind buffeted Ujurak's fur as he plunged down the mountain slope toward the rolling foothills below, where the caribou were grazing. It was late burn sky, and after the recent rains, the air was filled with delicious smells. Ujurak drew them in with every breath. Scents of prey, of green growing plants, and underlying it all, the salt tang of the sea. As he bounded down the slope, he glanced around at his friends. The white bear, Kallik, raced beside him, her stride as smooth as flowing water, her twitching nose sniffing the air. After so many moons of traveling through dark forests and over sun-baked rocks, Ujurak wondered if she could smell the sea ice at last, the smell of her home. He heard a whoomph and glanced back just in time to see the black bear, Lusa, tripping over her own paws in her haste to keep up. She rolled several bear lengths before scrambling up and continuing to pelt downward. She was the smallest of the four bears by a lot now, and she seemed to run two strides for every one of theirs, but she was never outpaced for long. And charging ahead, his tufty ears flattened by the wind, was the brown bear, Toklo, always out in front, always the first. Warmth welled up inside Ujurak. Toklo had trusted him enough to come with him all this way, so far that Ujurak could hardly remember the mountains where he had met Toklo and then Lusa. Suddenly, he wanted to be able to remember every paw step, picture every day they had spent walking, 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 all the way to the edge of the world. Because finally they had reached their journey's end. They'd found the last wilderness. Down on the grassy hills, the caribou raised their heads as the bears hurtled toward them. "Watch out!" Ujurak snarled. "Here we come!" Toklo glanced over his shoulder. "They're too big to hunt, feather brain," he called. Ujurak huffed at him. He wasn't really going to hunt the giant caribou. Strong as he was, he knew he was still small enough to run right under the bellies of the longest-legged creatures. He was just enjoying the feeling of unstoppable running, his paws skimming over the grass with a satisfying hiss, the fur along his flanks slicked down and rippling in the breeze he had created. They had reached the foothills now, swerving down the gently swollen slopes until they rushed straight into the herd of grazing caribou. Close up, the horned beasts were huge, and they swung their heavy heads to glance lazily at the bears, unafraid of Ujurak and his companions. There were so many of them, Ujurak couldn't see to the other side of the herd once he was on their level. All he could see was a forest of legs as thin as sticks, topped with pale, hairy bellies. The caribou's pelts gave off a powerful, musky scent that made Ujurak puff and wrinkle his nose. Toklo darted to one side and led the bears out of the herd, sending the caribou scattering. The valley opened up in front of them again, and Ujurak blinked in the bright sunshine. A vast green plain unrolled at his paws, dotted here and there with clumps of dark, spiky grass, with still silvery water just visible between the stalks. Through his wind-watering eyes, Ujurak could see patches of white where flocks of geese had landed to feed in the damp grassland. "This is the wilderness Kopuk promised us. Enough to feed us all, space for every bear, no sign of flat faces or fire beasts or black paths." Ujurak felt a sharp pain in his belly. The journey through Smoke Mountain had been a hard one, with little prey, and the sight of the geese awakened his hunger. He swallowed as his mouth filled with saliva. The grass blurred beneath his front paws as he pushed himself faster, thinking of nothing but a meal of tasty, plump goose. Then Ujurak felt his legs tingling and saw his forelegs begin to lengthen and grow thinner. His pelt prickled as his brown fur transformed into a rough gray pelt. Wolf! His snout grew longer, and he could feel his vision narrowing, the edges darkening as he focused on a single flock of geese on the plain. One flock. The sounds around him faded to insignificance, and all he could hear was the geese directly in front of him, honking and yakking, their noise growing louder and louder. His stride lengthened. He felt swift. As he raced past Toklo, he thought he heard the brown bear growl. But the sound seemed to come from far away. It meant nothing to Ujurak. The hot reek of the geese engulfed his senses. His tongue lolled as he pinpointed his prey. A fat white bird feeding at the edge of the flock. One goose. He could almost feel his teeth sinking through its feathers, crunching its bones. He smelled its blood and heard its heartbeat. Kill. One bite into warm prey. Then feed. The plain whirled past him in a blur, his paws hardly seeming to touch the marshy ground. He reached the edge of the flock. The birds flew up in a storm of flapping wings and terrified squawking. Snarling, Ujurak leaped on his chosen prey. His fangs closed on its neck. He shook the goose. It battered him with its wings, then went limp. Ujurak proudly lifted his head with his prey dangling from his mouth. Feed now. Taste blood. But something was gnawing at his mind. He couldn't eat yet. Reluctantly, he turned and began trotting back the way he had come. Ujurak felt his rangy wolf body begin to swell and thicken. Brown fur replaced the shaggy gray pelt, and his footsteps grew heavier. His heartbeat slowed as the wolf's hunger for blood died away. Gradually, he began to notice the plain around him again. The geese were settling a little way off, their raucous cries fading. Ujurak could hear the rattle of wind in the reeds and the splashing paws of an Arctic fox as it darted from one clump of bushes to another. He blinked in confusion as he saw three other bears approaching him, just coming off the foothills onto the plain. Black, brown, white. He felt that they ought to be familiar. Why can't I remember who they are?
Ujurak,
the small black bear bounded forward to meet him.
That was a great catch.
Thanks, Lusa.
Ujurak's confusion vanished as he stood in front of her and dropped the prey at Lusa's paws. Of course he knew who she was, and the other two bears padding up to him were his friends Toklo and Kallik. The long legs he had as a wolf had rapidly outdistanced them.
Come and share, he invited them.
Toklo growled his thanks as he tore off a part of the goose and retired a couple of paces to flop down and eat the new kill. Ujurak waited for the two she-bears to take some before he settled down to eat, too. The goose was a fat one, and there was enough to share among all of them. It tasted delicious, warm, in Ujurak's belly.
This is wonderful,
Kallik said, chewing enthusiastically. She raised her head and sniffed at the air.
Can you smell the ice? Soon the sea will freeze closer to shore, and I'll be able to get back to the white bear's feeding grounds.
But there's no shelter on the ice,
Lusa objected, her mouth full of juicy meat.
The wind will blow you into the sea.
No, we dig dens in the snow, Kallik explained. Then we curl up together, and it's so cozy.
Ujurak saw a shadow of sadness creep into her eyes, and he wondered if she was remembering her old life with her brother and mother. Kallik blinked, and the shadow vanished.
And we hunt for seals, through holes in the ice. You've never tasted anything as delicious as seal.
I'll settle for the brown earth under my paws and the prey I can catch on it.
Toklo jerked his head toward a distant ridge that was thickly covered with trees. Ujurak could see birds wheeling over it and sensed the throbbing life of small animals under the branches.
That's the best sort of place for brown bears, right, Ujurak?
Right,
Ujurak replied.
Look at all those trees,
Lusa said, pawing a feather from her muzzle. Her dark eyes sparkled with anticipation as she looked across at the tree-clad ridge.
I love sleeping in the branches, with the sound of the wind and the bear spirits close by.
Toklo tore off another mouthful of goose flesh.
What I like about this place, he said, gulping it down and swiping his tongue around his jaws, is no flat faces, no black paths, no fire beasts, no flat-faced dens.
Just open land and sea, wherever you look, Kallik said.
And all the prey we can eat, Toklo added.
Lusa sprang to her paws.
What should we do next?
She asked.
I want to find a tree to spend the night.
Let's rest for a bit, Toklo batted a paw at the eager little bear. There's plenty of time.
Ujurak finished eating his share. He was enjoying listening to his friends as they chattered excitedly about their new home. He had brought them here, to a place where they could be safe and well-fed and away from flat faces for the rest of their lives. He was licking his paws, feeling his belly full of warm meat, when a soft voice sounded inside his head. He stiffened as it whispered,
"Not the end."
Ujurak lifted his head, his pelt prickling as if it were crawling with ants. He quietly rose to his paws and stepped away from his friends, pretending to drink from a pool of water. He flattened his ears and listened in case the voice came again. He had heard this voice before. Many moons ago, it had spoken to him one cold night under a blaze of stars.
"Follow the pathway, star," it had said.
And when he had looked up, he had seen one star twinkling more brightly than the rest. He had chosen to ignore the voice at first, but it had whispered to him in the quiet moments as he curled up to sleep and before he rose in the morning.
"You will not travel alone," it had told him.
"What do you mean? There's nobody here." Ujurak had looked around, seeing nothing but the forest stretching into shadow as if he were the only bear in the world.
"They will find you," the voice promised.
Then he met the brown bear, Toklo, and his question was answered. He'd started to listen to the voice after that. If ever he had doubted the journey they were making, the voice inside his head urged him on, soft and insistent. Over time, he thought he'd figured out who it was, reaching to the edge of his memory the very first things he could remember. Ujurak lapped the ice-cold water from the pool. Above, a single star glimmered faintly in the dusky gray-blue sky.
"Not the end," the voice whispered again.
"I don't understand," Ujurak protested silently, gazing up at the pathway star. Then over the mountains, he saw a tiny black dot moving in the sky. No, there were three black dots. They moved closer, following the line of the ridge, and he could hear a distant buzzing. The dots grew bigger, and he saw the flash of evening sunlight on hard silver.
"Metal birds," he thought with alarm.
He glanced back at his companions. They hadn't noticed the dots in the sky. They were too busy arguing about which was better to live in, trees or caves. Ujurak watched the metal birds fly away into the distance. The clatter of their wings faded, echoing on the still air. Ujurak's fur prickled. Metal birds were flat-faced things, fire beasts of the air. So what were they doing here? Like Toklo had said about this place, no fire beasts,
no flat faces.
Ujurak looked at his friends again. Lusa cuffed Toklo, pretending to be angry with him when he said that trees were too full of twigs to be comfortable. They looked so happy. Ujurak felt his heart pounding in his chest.
"But I have brought them here, to this place," he told the voice inside his head. "There is nowhere left to go."
"Not the end," said the voice.
"Then what am I supposed to do?" Ujurak begged.
He listened for an answer, but all Ujurak could hear was the sound of the wind in the long grasses and the call of a gull.
Chapter 2. Lusa. Lusa stood at the top of a grassy hill, gazing across the plain. A cold wind flattened her fur against her face and made her eyes water. It brought with it the sense of ice and fish. In the distance, she could just make out the white edge of the ocean.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.